joy and oblivion. We're going on an orchestral odyssey into the emotional abyss in one of tonight's masterworks, Gustav Mahler's Sixth Symphony. It's an appropriately momentous piece for a prom that's been designated by UNESCO as the 2014 UNESCO Concert for Peace, this year when we're marking the 100th anniversary since the outbreak of World War I. But this is a vertiginously challenging symphony, technically and above all, emotionally. And it's conducted by a musician who has risk as his essential musical DNA and at the tips of his fingers, and with an orchestra who only rarely play together. Valery Gergiev conducts the World Orchestra for Peace, but before he and the orchestra get to the Mahler, they're taking on a work of sheer orchestral virtuosity and sumptuousness, Richard Strauss's symphonic fantasia on his opera Die Frau ohne Schatten. But believe me, tonight at the proms, anything could happen. Well, I've just heard the World Orchestra for Peace rehearse for the very first time Strauss's symphonic fantasia on Die Frau ohne Schatten. Now, to be honest, it sounds a bit like really what it is, which is 102 individuals from 78 orchestras in 32 countries. You know, it's a bit like a collection of ingredients that are meeting each other, but not quite coming together in that full gastronomic or musical experience. And they've only got 2 days for that to happen. Now, one of the orchestras, one of the countries represented, is Australia, the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra. The leader of their second violins is Monica Curro, and she's the co-principal leader of the second violin section in this performance of the Strauss and the World Orchestra for Peace. Now, I want to find out from Monica Curro what it's like to be part of this thrilling and rather dangerous orchestral experience.
The orchestra is an unusual creature where it's made up of extremely proficient and extraordinary soloists and leaders and concert masters, and so there's a lot of instruction that doesn't have to come from anybody because the level of proficiency is very high, but also the level of listening. And so they're not used to following anybody, they're used to leading people, and you have to listen to do that. And so everybody's listening. You can almost see the listening, it's that palpable.
Does that mean you get lots of leaders trying to lead?
You would think so, but it's not actually, because what happens in between every piece is there's vastly different seating. So there's never kind of an alpha person, because the person who will lead the Strauss, for example, will be in the fifth desk for the Mahler. So it's all very egalitarian and collegial, and everyone's just there to make it really good. And it's just a very auspicious occasion.
So in the middle of all that textural complexity of Strauss's music, are there any particular moments we should listen out for? Mostly from you, of course, but anywhere else in the orchestra as well.
There's a moment that starts in bar one and finishes at the end, because it's incredibly hard. There are billions of notes. And I was talking to the viola players as well. We were lamenting how it's not really in our contract to have to play that high. But Strauss didn't care. We're right up in mouth position. I'm getting a bit of vertigo, actually, my part. But yeah, it's definitely challenging, especially, as you say, on 2 days.
And it's throughout. It doesn't.
It's relentless. Relentlessly complicated. And the texture's so thick as well. You just can't. If you lose it, you're going to lose it. You're going to be lost for half a page.
And there are lots of fairy tale dimensions for us to get lost in as listeners to Strauss's music too. But there's no need to worry too much about the opera's story. It premiered in 1919 and Strauss made this fantasia in 1946. The story is about an immortal fairy who tries to steal the shadow of a human woman, but she fails in her quest thanks to an epiphany of compassion. But forget about all that, then instead luxuriate in the orchestral high wire act that you're going to see for the next 20 minutes or so, and hope that the players of the World Orchestra for Peace don't, in fact, get lost. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Well, frankly, I'm astonished. That journey from the first rehearsal of that piece that I heard with this orchestra to what we've just heard is like comparing a group of individuals to a fully fledged Strauss orchestra. Of course, it's a huge feat for the players, including Monica Caro. Look, Monica, how were those billions of notes for you?
Well, the funny thing is that you think that it's going to be horrendous, and it, like you said, we've only had a couple of days, but it was just divine. It was divine. I'm flanked by this Spanish genius here and this Concertgebouw monster here. Nothing could possibly have gone wrong. It was just so divine. The sound, the being in a part of that level and world of sound was just amazing.
But look, how has it happened? I mean, watching Gergiev conduct and watching you all move together as well. I don't know if there's a little fairy dust sprinkled on that magic toothpick with which he's conducting you tonight. But I mean, how is it actually happening? I mean, are you aware of how this is actually possible?
Well, I think there's a completely different level of concentration at the gig rather than the rehearsals. In the rehearsals, you're thinking about your own thing and the nuts and bolts, and maybe that fingering wouldn't have been so good as that other one, and I have to listen out for the violas there. But the in a dialogue conversation completely stops in the concert. It's just play, and everyone just goes, it's like being, I don't know, hit by a wave or something. It was just fantastic.
Monica, thank you. Listen, I've got to let you prepare for the next behemoth on this program.
Oh, that's easy compared with
really.
Yeah. That's my bread and butter. I don't do opera.
It's unbelievable. See, yeah. That just shows what this orchestra is capable of. Monica, thank you.
Thanks.
This prom also featured the European premiere of Roxana Panufnik's Three Paths to Peace, a performance you can see exclusively on the new music collection on the BBC iPlayer. But next, Mahler's Sixth Symphony. Now, this is a work that conductor Valery Gergiev knows intimately. He's conducted it many times all over the world over the last couple of decades. But you can't take any performance of this piece for granted, no matter how many times you've done it. I met him at rehearsals and asked him what kind of challenge this is to put together this enormous symphony with an orchestra who've only just met in a couple of days.
Yes, there is a challenge. You need a good orchestra. There is no chance you can make a good orchestra if musicians do not hear extremely well. They have to understand each other and hear. That's how you make music together. They are playing together. This is the feeling. This is your colleague here. And you listen. And then you listen to the one who is maybe 20 meters away from you. But you listen all the time. You can't make a good concert if you don't hear. And, of course, Mahler, his Sixth Symphony, has this anxiety, even fear sometimes, that something terrible can happen. That's why his Sixth Symphony sometimes is called tragic. There are many moments which are clearly nothing to do with tragedy. He's so close to nature and the beauty of landscape. When you have cowbell just transports you completely, takes you somewhere else.
The cowbells are, I mean, they're in the first movement as a vision at the middle of the first movement. They're in a lot in the slow movement and in the finale too.
Yes, and I think this symphony does not predict any historical events.
So it's not like a premonition of the First World War, you don't think?
No, I don't think particularly this symphony. I think in this symphony's You hear something what doesn't make people feel protected, feel comfortable, feel very well placed, you know.
Ain't that the truth? This symphony contains some of Mahler's most hallucinogenically nightmarish music, above all in its half-hour-long finale. But in the three movements that come before it, there are images of grotesque playfulness in the scherzo, of uneasy alpine tranquility in the slow movement that comes second. And in the very first movement, you hear a dark march right at the start of the symphony that drives the music on to soaring heights of expressive intensity and passion and down to lows of implacable torment. And the whole symphony ends by consigning its hero and us as its listeners to a fate of horrifying and tragic desolation. Prepare yourselves for the next 80 minutes of music, just as these musicians are preparing to take you on a journey of musical and existential discovery.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
It's difficult to know how to respond to the experience of living and dying, metaphorically at least, through Mahler's Sixth Symphony. Applause seems a bit weird to me. I mean, what are we applauding? Our own emotional wreckage, the end of all things? Questions that don't have easy answers. But perhaps that's the point of this work and this concert. We're all left with a challenge about how we deal with the trauma of this symphony, individually, ourselves, and collectively, as an audience, as a community. And maybe that's the connection between this prom, this orchestra, the World Orchestra for Peace, and some wider idea of peace, that it's up to us what happens next.
Proms continue.